So that I did not into a banner bunch. Yeah, a couple new people.
Very cool.
Banner bunch is something we started doing last year, about November. So we've done it almost a year, once a month we get together and we talk about topics that relate to banner and the data and the processes that we use. And we've gotten a lot of feedback from it, but it's been very positive. And we really enjoy doing it. So it's been a lot of fun. Everybody else that's in here, we took a couple months off in the summer. We learned that summertime is not a lot of people on campus. So people process going forward, both duties in the fall and spring and winter. The summertime will probably take off. We got a couple of months to do this. Helps us out too, and something to do for us. So while we go through this presentation, you will notice that occasionally I come up here and maybe fill with these settings. This is for our recording. We record all of these so that if you do miss them or you want to watch them again, you can see them all on our YouTube channel. We get put them up on the LBCC media channel and see that. So we are the Banner Bunch. We've got a fairly standard agenda. Most every time we meet, we go through kind of the same process. We do introductions. If you'd love for you to meet our team, the applications assistant program and team, and our primary responsibility is to support them. We want you to be able to put names, their faces, and we want to get them in here. So this is people really care about experiences. We usually have a topic that's fairly small, so we can talk about for 20 minutes or more. We'll go through the training, and then the rest of the time is actually what we do. So we can keep talking about a subject, or we can ask questions about other things, or we can update you on projects that we're working on, all sorts of things. So, on our team, we have got Kimmy, we have Mark, Tyler, we just learned your name. Teresa, Lori, Carl, Lena is our administrative ninja. She's here with us. She's probably back in the office right now. My name is Gabriel Williams, and our CIO joins us, Michael Kleiner.
Good morning.
Very supportive. So before I advance to the next slide, who doesn't know what propane is? And this is a safe space, we can all be honest, all right? It stays at Banner Bunch. So what happens at Banner Bunch stays at Banner Bunch. So one of those leaders, and more people are curious about the interaction or the use of the profile. You can tell me what PURPOSE stands for. That's the acronym. He's not allowed to say it. I want to hear somebody else. Family, educational, rights, and privacy. This is a federal regulation that governs pretty much everything we do here. Bonus points. Who knows when FERPA was put back? 1974. FERPA's a pretty old regulation. It's been around for 42 years. Actually, the first day's coming up in November. It was signed into effect by George Floyd. So
wow.
It's been around. It's been updated throughout the years, but it's a good thing to know the gist of, because all the data that we do or work with is covered by FERPA. So if you go out to the FERPA website or if you look up FERPA, at the very top they almost always have this sentence. This is the synopsis of what FERPA is. It is the federal law that protects the privacy of student educational records. And so what that means is that our students have the right to privacy. All their information is their information. And we only have access because we have a legitimate educational interest to know that students are here. So when we're working with people's data, and this team is very concerned with data because we support the database that houses a lot of this data. This data also can exist in Moodle, or it can be in Moodle Shadow, or maybe it's in the like that, maybe it's on paper. All of these students' data belong to them, and they deserve privacy. They can't release that information to anybody other than them. We'll have lots of caveats to that going on. Not only that, but just because we have access to some of this information in the system, when we look to register our office and we look up registration, we're able to anybody that's ever been here, it doesn't mean that you can't that testers. We don't have a reason to look at people's data based on what they're doing. That's the foundation to try to focus what they're using and have the need to do sort of what. If anybody's dealt with HIPAA and health, that's pretty much the same thing a lot of our healthcare information and that was modeled on HIPAA. Now it's not. One of the things that's really important to HIPAA is that the MedStar's office is the data owner. They are the authority on this conflict. They're responsible for making sure they put that diagram, and they're the experts on whether or not it's important. So if you ever have a question about FERPA data, or somebody's information, or somebody's asking questions for information, you can always refer back to the MedStar's office. In fact, as we go through examples today, oftentimes my answer is going to be, talk to the MedStar's office. Everybody knows who our registrar is, right? Danny Ames. Danny Ames. He's not here with us today. He's in the conference in San Diego. That it happens. So, not all data in the systems that we deal with, all the information that we deal with is pretty detailed. And so, it's good to know a couple of words here. And one of the big ones is directory information versus non-directory information. FERPA protects the privacy of non-directory information. But then some information in our system is considered public. FERPA defines this very specifically in the law, but we also define this definition of what is directory and what is not in our new board policies and administration. So we always go out there for curious as to whether or not something's directory or not. I've put together the list of what we have published right here. It comes down to name, address, telephone, email, sort of things that you could see in a phone book, if you actually use phone books anymore. Enrollment status, dates of attendance, their major, the school that they're in or division of college, degrees or awards received. And then we have a couple that are very specific to sports, whether or not they're participating in official activities or sports, the public information, as well as the height and weight between them. I always thought it was weird. But I guess it's for like publishing in the newspaper. That's considered that information. This information is considered public. And so we can release this information. But what I challenge you to question yourself every time somebody asks for something, it should be released. If we have somebody called up and asked for John Smith's email address or phone number, that should set off red flags and make you think, I don't know if I should really give you this information. I'm going to send you to the website's office. Anything outside of this list is considered non-directory information. And that's what FERPA is all about, non-directory information. That data, grades or registration or holds or the balance on their account, all that information and more can only be released to the eligible student, to that student themselves. And they've got to prove that they are who they say they are. You can't just take their word on it. They call up on the phone and say, my name is John. I'd like to get grades. Here's my idea, but I happen to know that. You can't just release it. You've got to go through a legal process to make sure they are who they say they are. And most of our offices have that sort of process built in. But if you're not sure, or you have questions, back to the registrar's office. There's another kind of flavor of data that's out there. You'll hear us refer to it a lot. This is one that we're really interested in. Personally identifiable information, PII. And what it comes down to is this is information that if somebody had this information or a combination of this information, they'd be able to figure out who you're talking about or easily identify who that student is. Oftentimes, my rule of thumb is if I can use this information to steal someone's identity, that's PII. Any combination of this information with non-directed information cannot be disclosed. Like a professor or a faculty member can't release a list of grades for people's SSN standard and textbooks, like a PGAP, or date of birth, or a photograph.
You can't even use their name or their ID number.
Exactly. You can't use their name, you can't use their address, their ID number, family members, their date or place of birth, mother's name, all this information is personally identifiable information, and so I have a heightened level of security around it. or be very careful with historical information, especially if it's tomorrow's blind record. So the students have a couple of options. There's a couple of caveats to all these rules. The number one is confidentiality. If a student chooses to be confidential, to be private, they can fill out a form at the registrar's office, and put that form online. I don't know if it's made online. So you can get it online and they can deliver it to the registrar's office. And what that does is that makes all their information private, including that. So, the height and weight of an athletic number that's data confidential cannot be used. The phone number, you know how to call that. In fact, you can't even release whether or not they are secret. If you're either confirmed or denied that they have no care of the pattern of their identity. It's very important to always pay attention to whether or not you did it. There's a few places you can tell. If you have access to Banner ID, the Banner Administrative Code, SBA VS Davis has a confidentiality effect. And that's where you can see, and that's the one place where you need to turn around to these points. In fact, as you go around inside Banner and bring some of these information up, if they are confidential, you need to get a warning that says this person's information is if you're out in WebRunner looking at information, there's a little yellow triangle that will say this person's information is confidential. They're fairly easy to notice as long as you're paying attention to it. But it's something you should always be paying attention to. Many of our reports have the confidential flag on it, but I don't know if this prevents it from everyone. The other thing is disclosure authorization. So just because somebody is a parent of a student doesn't mean you can give them your information. In fact, FERPA protects that. You can only give information to the student. But oftentimes, parents want to leave that information. So a student can come in and fill out an authorization form with the registrar. It's in the same place as the confidentiality form on our website. We go to the registrar's office, they have to deliver that in person. Yep. And they can do that in WebRunner. And what this does is they'll select a person, they'll identify a person that they're willing to disclose information to, and they set up a passphrase as well that you need to have to disclose that information. There's one place in Banner where you can see this, SWABISC. You can see this information, but I don't know if everybody has access to that. So if a parent is calling up and asking for information, or a police officer, or a military recruiter, or anybody else, best practice is probably to send them to the registrar's office. And that's a tough one. You get a lot of angry parents, people demanding that they pay their bill, and you know, or this is a tax dependent. You cannot release information to anybody but that student or an operator.
And what's interesting is I've even had people who work by say, my son, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, right. Like you.
Michael's got a great example of his wife wants to see his son's grades.
Nope,
you cannot do that.
I just tell her we're happy or not knowing.
So there are some, if you look at the FERPA regulations, very in-depth, they mention that an eligible student is somebody who's over 18 or has entered into college. We're a college, so if they're here, regardless if they're 17 or over, you can go over. When in doubt, ask the registrar's office. One thing that I've noticed a lot of campuses, though, tend to take the most restrictive approach. You know, even though technically a K-12 student can release information or recruit information about students here yet, typically it's no, we go back to all information private. We don't release a record information to the public if you have questions. Go to the registrar's office. So, where are the reports start talking about these things? Have questions, go to examples, have lots of examples. We've been picking up this for a couple of weeks now. I've sat down with the community and got a couple of people for it. We've seen great bosses in place here on the road. Any questions for us? So So how do you deal with this one? It comes up and says, I want a drink. Or, minus five. Do I drop it yet? And then, how do you get reset with me? How do you identify that that's actually the best? What do you say? Let me ask you for your ID. A photo ID. A student ID. Don't provide them an ID and say, hey. You can ask them other questions. What sort of questions do you follow up at all? Other questions?
Well, we don't know this about IDs or the phone.
Right.
Someone calls a phone number. We want to do that. We will ask them their name and birthday, and we'll use the best. But we wouldn't give them any, ID information.
Birthday is pretty easy to hold on. Your friends on Facebook.
Right. You can usually tell, I think, you know, if it's something with them, they don't necessarily know their birthday. They're like, oh, it's not a June. What is it? You know, they don't believe necessarily.
Right, all of us have a little bit of intuition, especially when we're
right.
True.
Yeah, exactly.
This doesn't sound quite right.
Some guy just
kind of
goes
somewhere,
woman's address or something, you know, and it's not a recruiter, and you can't really figure out a reason for it. I mean,
we'll
give
up on information. Right,
what is your catchphrase?
When in doubt, don't give it out.
When in doubt, don't give it out. Just because you can give out that information, I don't think you should oftentimes.
Mm-hmm.
I think you have a pretty open policy compared to other institutions on what you consider record information that I've looked at. I looked at some where we couldn't even tell anybody was a student, you know,
right.
We didn't get enough information. So ours is a lot of class and a lot of ideas.
The same goes with parents. I mean, even if somebody's up in the front desk with you and there's a parent saying, or somebody that looks like a parent saying, I saw a student, until you confirm exactly who that person is and that you can disclose information to that person, you can't talk about non-directory information further. In fact, you have to separate them from the student to talk to student information about them.
Yes, it's instructed, you don't have to give it out.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, Debbie Zeller had another thing. What was it? Don't be afraid to be rude.
Yeah.
Better than being sued.
Yeah, being rude is better than being sued. That's
it. Being rude is better than being sued. Right. And a lot of times, we might trip over ourselves into trying to be too helpful. You know, this person's in need, they're in a rush, they've got a crying baby going on, just like that, we're not helping out. But we really need to be strict about her we're required for it.
I had a student go up to me
for
family the other day, and it was funny because he wanted a bus ticket. So he had his ID out already. We have to check and make sure they're enrolled for the term before we get a bus ticket, right? So I'm like, well, let's see if you're enrolled. And I stopped and went, oh, this is funny. I said, I wouldn't be able to tell you anything further if you hadn't provided that because you've got confidential on your. So, yeah, it's funny where it pops up.
Right. I think the confidentiality comes from the second nature of the person. And you do is they're more disturbed and look them up. And that confidential thought will come up with their confidential. Other examples of where this has come up.
Moderately up. We have folks that we call it, see if their spouse or someone they know is in the learning center. And we can't tell them because most of our staff don't have access to data. So we won't confirm whether someone is a student. We won't confirm whether someone is present in the building. We say that if this is an emergency, we
right. It's an emergency type of situation to talk about. We just want to know something with a student, the registrar's office, who is always collecting the information. We're not going to collect the information to collect the another example I get, or we get quite often, I actually is somebody calling up to an anonymous from this company, or I'm a grad student doing this sort of research, I didn't know this, but all of a sudden, you can pick them up, see their name, but they get public. Typically, they get that out. But that immediately shows you. Why did you need a list of what you were doing? Also,
when you think about that. Here's all 3,716.
Right. And so whenever we get those sort of requests, we always start trying to figure it out. We need to send them to the website. They have the tools and the ability to do whether or not person that needs this information, and then they have access to it, whether or not you can work with this institution to send that to you.
We have a policy up there also for like realtors who request student information. Mm-hmm. And there's a charge for that. There's requirements.
Right. What other sort of questions do you have, for example?
So for disclosure, is there an expiration date?
As long as we hold the record.
But our policy is
No, they're still there.
But
we can see the date. Although,
they enter and expire. So they do expire. You can see that in that form. Or you can ask the registrar's office. There's also a passcode on that. So you have to be careful to make sure you verify that. This is really a person that has a passcode. One thing I want to show you is I have provided all of all this information is available on these links. I send out these slides at the end, and they're available on the video that you put on YouTube. But these links spell out a lot of these policies. And when you hear the field, that first link is actually the FERPA Department of Ed website. I've got our board policies and ARs listed here. 7040 is policies that refer specifically to student rights and information. We have a webpage that we present to students. In fact, I think Bruce, from UTS and that all students say, these are your rights as a student. This spells out perfectly done. And then this bottom one has all the forms and policies we're talking about that directory, the confidentiality, and sending out the other examples or questions.
On the placement side of the house, I'm thinking separate from the parent has something signed by their child for their student that's not transferred to the side of the house. There's a different form.
Another example we hear fairly often on the faculty side of things is grading and attendance. A lot of people use like Excel to keep track of things or their own little systems on the computer. Is that a FERPA violation? Yeah, it depends. It could be. It really depends on how that information is used, whether or not it's secure. How many people here lock their workstation the second they stand up and walk into the desk?
We've got IT going between the desks.
Everybody in this room can lock their workstation with a lock away from their desk. If you need to turn your back on your screen, somebody else can lock it and have access.
The first time we should have had a Windows icon.
Windows up. Kind of a thing that you guys use the password to get back in, but it's great. That's you. That's Steve. Windows up. Or control, so you can log in. But back to the subsolid thing. Can you email that to somebody? No. Then it's in an email accessibility. Google Docs, that's a good question.
Well, I'm just saying.
It's a security idea.
Okay, because I pass IDs back and forth with other staff. Is that
perfect?
No, I just mean it's secure enough.
It's in there.
Yeah, it's in there. But you're just using X numbers.
Yes.
So that's your.
Are you combining that with non-directory information?
She needs to.
Yeah.
You know, part of her job. It's part of their job. So they need to access that information. Please don't have to work with my work.
My concern is our email system.
Well, I hope so, because
I think we all use it, but, you know. We don't own it, so I just have to.
Yeah.
Well, the security of email should always be a little suspect. I usually tell people, don't send anything in email that you don't want the world to know, because they could find out. It's not likely that they will, but they could. So, for instance, it's our policy to never send passwords or authentication information right over email.
I will never send PII in email.
Right.
Or any attachments to email. Yeah, so sending an email or any information is on that screen. I will put it in email.
There's one question about
email. Yeah. Is Google Docs secure? If you have a Google Sheet out there with a bunch of non-directory information, is that an okay practice? And Google Docs is, Google Apps is one of our standards here. I think that's worth asking. I don't know if I know the answer to that. I suspect that it's okay. Right, whether or not that sheet is public or
not.
All that can be pulled up as part of an audit. All that middle of the workstation is taken up by the user. But once that's the information, then that student has a right to privacy for that user. As far as Google Sheets and Google Docs goes, I think we're exactly where I'm. You have to keep it public, you have to be careful who you share that with.
Even
Keep it private. Do not make it public. Be careful who you share with, because they need to have an educational, legitimate educational interest in their information.
Others.
So if you want to protect that, there is a choice of where you can put it. This is for that document, so it has to be registered and checked out.
How many people use Google Apps versus Microsoft Office? Google Apps? Microsoft Office? You're not sure? Another thing on this example of Excel spreadsheets or having to be outside of Banner or Moodle, never ever put anything on Flash Drive. Period. Flash Drive, the minute you've got it on there, you lost and dropped and left in the bathroom or library or somewhere else or something like that. Don't use Flash Drive. That's an immediate risk. Like when I used to work in an office of admissions at OSU, we banned Flash Drive. You cannot have one in the office. You're checking out the door. You can't have money keychain. You can't connect your phone to your computer, but that's a drive. Also, make sure your computer is secure. Is your antivirus running? Is your information on your computer secure? Because that becomes a risk. You can accidentally disclose things and not even know it. If somebody else has access to your machine.
A question that just came on my mind too concerning that is that mean that if we have any reason to keep data on our computer, like in our workspace, would we prefer to use an iDrive instead of like a My Documents folder for security?
I put everything in my iDrive and the U Drive just as a practice because I don't consider anything on my computer permanent. I have a service tab and I imagine I could just drop that walking out of this room and everything on it's locked. I keep everything in the high value that you've got just available to you, but it also keeps it a little bit more secure. And it's backed up everything. Yeah, that should just be a best practice anyway. It's just like locking your workstation and walk away or having a password on your screen saver. Other questions, for example, we've actually got another 15 or 20 minutes here.
We've been talking electronics for this day, but don't forget that we have stuff on our desk that has information on it, and there's definitely a couple of words that going to my daughter's registration at the high school, and there were sheets that had social security number on it, and they're right tied up in a basket, where everybody's walking by to look at it. So make sure that you're aware of what's on your desk. We're not allowed, but I have, when I leave at night, I have to lock up anything that has social security number information on it to lock it up. I put it in the vault. So be very conscious of what's on the paper on your desk. You may turn off your screen so somebody can't read your screen. But that doesn't prevent people from walking by it.
And I'll keep in mind that there's something. When in doubt, don't do that. Better to do it when you see.
Yeah, my thing is just practice not to give out the information.
Just don't do that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I did provide all these links with a lot of information in there. If you look at the other one, now you can open this up to any question, anything at all, if you're curious about it, especially if you're new. I can always say anything to ask. I'll give you a couple of just five of this while we're here, and then we're out of time tonight anyway, I think that's okay. The big thing that's on our phones every day is the FaceTime. Keep your notes go on a baseline project. So what that is, the Banner Baseline Project is basically taking our system to a way that it's delivered and have better support at state. We actually have one of the oldest Banner systems. For the first community college to do a Banner 1.0, we got a 26-year-old data. When Banner 1.0 came out, there wasn't a lot of functionality in there. There's a lot of things that were missing. So best practice at that time is just build it yourself. renting the programmers and building. But over the years, Elysium has released a lot of cool information, a lot of cool functionality. Elysium is a couple of years back. And we may or may not have migrated off of our homebrew stuff to the stuff that's delivered. So that's what this push is about. Trying to figure out how new needs that we've built over time or question them that specific, and migrating over to something that is delivered to us and taking advantage of the software that we have. Our goal is to be 100% based on these ideas. So on that project right now, we're about to finish up and wrap up an inventory of everything we've ever done. And it's taken us most of the summer to go and look for across the entire system and really how we've got things set up. And what we've got that's changed or what we've built that's not even in the product that's delivered to us. And there's thousands of things. So we're going to start meeting with the functional areas here over the next couple months, but build projects as to a direct deposit. We're originally built on a direct deposit system. Banner has that now. We can migrate it to that. It might be different. We might have to figure out how to use and use the product as it's delivered, but we do exactly the same thing we built. But we can make those changes. Move over to the new system and figure out what needs to do that. Sure enough. There's lots of things. Lots of things.
Squad is.
It's a relationship for the main system and proxy access is what they call it. They don't make sense to get out of this and move to that. So that's one of the biggest primary things for our team. Building this inventory, looking at the analytics, how it's supposed to be used and how it's going to be. We're bringing in consultants to help us out because a lot of us can use the analytics in any way. And then once we've gotten to a much more basic state, once we're using the product the way that that's a feature, then we can start to use the first step, like standing up a mobile app or installing the computer. Having a data specific. So we're excited about it, but it's kind of work. It's going to take time. That's our big one. Anything else you guys think about in that big one? Upgrade cycles. Everybody's involved with apps, the administrative system steering committee knows stuff about upgrade cycles. We move to a process where every quarter we update Banner and bring it to the nearest version we can to being up to date. We've been really successful doing that over the past year or so. Right now, Kimmy is going to be the lead for this next cycle, October through December. And she sent out the calendar for that, when we're going into like the instances and what the upgrades are and when you're looking at documentation. So Carl will be back there up on this side. Our goal is, I think the maintenance weekend is December 10th, is our maintenance weekend. We'll be rolling everything into production by then. So if you're involved in testing, you want to test over the next month or so after you've got inventory development. If you have any questions about what to test or how to test or what's changed or what's the same, we know you can have to answer those questions. This is Kimmy's first time looking at updated cycle. It's awesome. Here we go. I love updated cycle. Anything else? Well, about 10 minutes early. I don't mind closing early. If you'd love me to ask you questions. We are always available to serve you. If you have a business question early, you can send this email address. So I want to support you. I'll be kind of annoying you along. But that is our email address. It goes to the entire group. Everybody is good in this world. That's that email. And then this bit.ly, the short link, takes you to the LVCC Benefit YouTube video. I got a half dozen out there on certain topics, and let us know if you want to see certain topics in the future. If you have any questions, all right, thank you. Thank you.